Thanks.
Joshua. Okay, so these were things I used to lecture on quite a few years ago. And so this is, can you hear me okay? I don't have a microphone, so I hope it's okay. Tell me if I should speak louder or what. Okay, so I want to sort of review these problems from yesteryear in terms of various things, partly to remind ourselves of what some of the problems are, also to see updates on the progress toward solution of some of the problems. That's the idea. So the best reference for what's been done on the problems is Wikipedia. My favorite, Google is my favorite source of information in science. But usually they tend to refer one to Wikipedia. So I always go through Google, and then you get Smale's problems under Wikipedia. And then they give a list of 18 problems. And then they have next to it a column status. And that gets updated. That we have evidence pretty fast, although there's not too much change in most of the problems. Okay, so I'm going to go through the ones listed by Wikipedia where the status is remarked on. And there are two of those which one could be, it's fair to say, for two of the 18 problems, there is some kind of a serious solution. I always say that a good problem is never solved. A great problem is never solved. And I still believe that. I mean, still one can find a lot of new concepts and new proofs and general things like that. But nonetheless, one could say that two of these problems are really solved. And I'm going to address those two first. The first one, I think most of you know. My second problem was Poincaré's conjecture, dimension 3, and that has been solved by Gregory Perelman, of Leningrad, of St. Petersburg. And just the only thing I can say is I was at Paris a year and a half ago, which was a big celebration of this solution. By the Clay Institute, and the goal of that celebration was to award its $1 million prize to Gregory Perelman. Okay, and so I spoke there, and there's quite a few speakers at this Paris meeting, big celebration. Perelman didn't come. He didn't want to come. But they had the celebration anyway, and they said that they would still give him the $1 million, but he had to decide sometimes. In the meantime, since then, they withdrew the $1 million, since he, I think, said he didn't want it very firmly, maybe a few weeks after this meeting. But nonetheless, he has solved this, and it's a good lesson for us. The solution is not in any established journal. It's not in any journal at all. It's just on some website. So there we see why journals, the role of journals is not quite so crucial in the course of history of mathematics. Okay, the second problem that one could say is solved is what I list, I think, is problem 14 on the Lorentz attractor. The Lorentz attractor was found by Edward Lorentz when he was looking at the ordinary differential equations associated to prediction of weather. And he found this very strange looking object, strange attractor of some kind. It was one of the historic strange attractors, very important. And he did all of this numerically. Okay, so I got to know Lorentz pretty well during those years. what happened was that the Lorentz attractor inspired a mathematical model of that attractor in dynamics, a mathematical model, synthetic if you want, but a rigorous model, mainly by Bob Williams. So this was a very clean picture of some attractor, which one could understand everything about. One could read off everything from the mathematical model. But the question I asked in problem number 14, was that really the same as what Lorentz found numerically? And the answer is yes. It was found with a lot of computation, using a lot of computation by Warwick Tucker. And so that is the second problem that one could say fairly, the problem is solved. Both that and the Poincaré conjecture I consider very important contributions to mathematics. Okay, so now let me go to two other problems which are mentioned in Wikipedia. The first one has to do with centralizers of diffeomorphisms. And so we have a diffeomorphism is a differentiable homeomorphism with a differentiable inverse. Okay, so if you take a compact C infinity manifold, so this is a problem in terms of C infinity functions. C infinity maps of a manifold into itself with a C infinity inverse. We call that diff. We call it C infinity of M. So this is a nice group, infinite dimensional group. And I asked, is set of centralizers in this group centralizers, like if T is in the group, then we can say it's centralizer Z of T is the set of all elements of the group which commute with T, same as in general algebra. So the question is Z of T generically, most of the time, equal to the minimum, equals to just the integers, equals the powers of T. This is for K belongs to the integers. Okay, so a centralizer always contains all the iterates of the object itself, of the diffeomorphism. The question is, generically, is there anything else? Or for most elements in this group, are there nothing else which commutes with it besides its own powers? That was the question. Okay, it was plausible, and I thought that was a very hard question and would help to help understand some things which are very, very hard, because dynamical systems in this kind of generality is an extraordinarily tough subject with hundreds, thousands even of people working on different aspects of that. So this was the question. That was one of my problems, is problem 12. Now we have some answer. The answer is yes. If we use C1 instead of C infinity, that's a hard theorem. Amy Wilkinson is the main person I know among the three authors who solved it. Amy Wilkinson, she's at Northwestern or the University of Chicago. So this is a partial answer only. So it remains for C2, C3, and so on. So a lot remains. And I guess it's going to be a long time before this is solved in general. That's my guess. It will take some very substantial new ideas to improve on the C1 case. Okay, so don't hesitate to ask me questions as I proceed. I was going to touch on some of the main things in this list of problems, because there's so much. Even when I was at the time when I proposed these problems, I gave a number of lectures on the problems, but even then, all I could do was focus on maybe half a dozen of the problems in one lecture if I was going to explain anything. Okay, so a little more background on that, on these problems. The background was just interesting for me. The first account of the problems I gave was a footnote of my paper, Mathematical Problems for the Next Century, because this was the last century. Then it says in the footnote, lecture given on the occasion of Dima Arnold's 60th birthday at the Fields Institute, Toronto, June 1997. So that's interesting. First of all, it gives a date. Second of all, it reminds me that the first time I talked about these things was here, at the Fields Institute. Okay, I made this list of problems because Dima Arnold, who's president of the International Mathematical Union, wrote a few people inspired by Hilbert's list of problems of the 100 years earlier, maybe they could suggest some list of problems for the future. So I took him up on that, I think more than any other mathematician, and that was the result. The result was this article. It's an article in the Mathematics Intelligencer, I listed these 18 problems in that. Subsequently, they wanted an account in some book published by the American Math Society. And I had already published this in the Intelligencer. I think when I was here and gave that lecture, the Intelligencer, Chandler Davis, the editor, asked me if the Intelligencer could publish it. I said, okay. But then Arnold says he would prefer, when they publish this with the other lists, that I would add a few more problems, make it a little newer, and I did. I added 3 more problems. Okay, so we have 21 counting the extra 3, and I said at the time, these 3 problems are nice, interesting, but they're not as important as the 18. That was what I felt. Okay, so that's the background, and then it was published in this book by the American Math Society, this new version with 3 new problems. Okay, so here we have a partial solution. And now I want to talk about this is just a couple years ago, and now I want to talk about late news, very up-to-date news, and it shows the Wikipedia is really up-to-date, because this is something that was very new. And Wikipedia, it seems to me, has it right. Okay, this is the 17th problem. 17th problem has had a vast amount of work on it, success, largely successful. I wanted to just say a few words about that. So the 17th problem, we take a polynomial system. Say of n polynomials, say the complex. This is complex. With n polynomials and n variables. Okay, so they will have, according to Bézout's theorem, they will have n solutions, generally speaking. So the problem I asked was, can that problem be solved approximately in polynomial time? So find the solutions. Find the zeros. in polynomial time. Approximately, and mostly. One has to add some of this because some of the input, some of the polynomial systems are ill-posed. One cannot really find any solutions. So we have to exclude some ill-posed problems. But almost all of them can be solved, and the question is to solve them approximately. So this isn't quite formally stated here, but that polynomial time was inspired by work I had done with Lenore Blum and Mike Chu, and later with Felipe Cooker. It's a kind of a complexity that I long before had thought was important, and the Turing complexity was inadequate for problems like this. Turing complexity is a bit complexity, and so it doesn't measure the things that are really used in their scientific computation, say broadly. Scientific computation certainly has many problems of this type, and this the classical method of complexity doesn't really make so much sense. That was my feeling. I feel it even more so today, and that those ideas permeated some of the problems in our list. Okay, so this means count the number of arithmetic operations, and the input of this is going to be the set of coefficients of the polynomial system, and the output are approximate solutions. And the question is, can this be done with a polynomial time? And if we take input n, so number of operations, arithmetic operations, we give this solution approximately, and generally is bounded by a constant. And now we have to write up here polynomial in n, where we have n is the number of operations. So we want to be able to solve it with this bound, polynomial in n, that just means n to some fixed power. Okay, so I've done a lot of work on this problem with Mike Trub, and other people had got some nice answers. But now, there's this article which I think summarizes everything with almost a complete answer. It's referred to in Wikipedia. And it was just published. This is Felipe Cooker and Peter Bergeser. It was published just in the last few weeks in the Annals of Mathematics. It's a tour de force, 50-page paper, and it uses lots of work that had been done previously by various people, Beltran, Pardo, Mike Shub, and many others, and myself, too, way back. So this is, let me say, it's almost an answer. And they get a bound, it's constant, times n log n. So this is very close to this. But n log n is not bounded by n to some fixed power. So it's very, very close, about as close as you could imagine without it being true. So this is very close to a complete solution of the problem. And I had this paper here, Bergeser and Cooker, on a problem posed by Steve Smale. and it is exactly this 17th problem in our list. And they give some history and the whole final proof depending on these other papers. So this is a problem that is so close to being finished, one just has to bring this power down to like n to the 10th would be better to do with the problem. If you have n to the 10th, that would solve the problem, but n log n is not bounded by n to the 10th.
Very, very close.
Okay? So I think that's as I say, almost a solution of that problem. And it's a little amazing because when you're looking at these things, it looks like the solutions are, this could be in high-dimensional spaces. And it looks like there's so much room in those high-dimensional spaces, it would be extremely difficult to get this kind of a solution. But they found that. Okay, so let me go on. There's another problem I should just mention. I had a lot of work on it. This is the seventh problem on the list. I'm not going to be too precise here, but the idea is we take a two-sphere. And I should say, in some of these situations, Mike Shoup played a role because I worked on this with Mike Shoup. And Mike Shoup was here during the last year at the University of Toronto and the Fields Institute, connected a lot with things like this paper. This paper was first discussed and lectured on here at the Fields Institute just a matter of less than a year ago. Okay, so the seventh problem asks for the following. We want to, given some positive integer n, we want to distribute n points here, x1, x2, x3, up to xn, so they are spaced very well. They can't, there's not enough symmetries in the two-sphere to expect an exact answer. But we want to have these endpoints, x1 up to xn, just given n. We want to find such points on the two-sphere so they have a pretty even distribution. And you can get particular cases of this by just looking at electrons constrained to be on the two-sphere, and use the electronic potential to minimize it. So there are lots of different versions of this, but this is the idea. And the idea is to use some kind of a potential, and you want to minimize that. You cannot minimize it, but you can get approximate answers. But the question is to get an approximate answer with some good accuracy pretty fast. So we want to do this good accuracy. And fast is polynomial time. Time is a polynomial at n. And this problem has received enormous attention. And I would say a lot of beautiful papers have been written on this. Saf, Ed Saf, Beltran, from Spain. Beltran is the same person that made a big contribution to this problem with Kuker and Bergesser. Before them, Beltran was one of the people who had done some good intermediate results finding a random algorithm. Here we are talking about deterministic ordinary algorithm. Okay, so what I can do, I think this is very beautiful. But there is a good summary of this, just given to me a couple months ago by Beltran. So Beltran has a summary, the state of the art in Smale's seventh problem. So I'm sure if you look up Beltran, Carlos Beltran, if necessary, you can email him, or you might find it on his website, I don't know. But it's a very, very nice account of surveying everything that's been done on that. But there is a lot of numerical work, so these things can be found pretty numerically, but it was a tougher question than I realized. So that all this work is immensely far from providing a solution. So that it's not close to being solved. Those things you just don't know in advance, but after intense work, the way I stated it is miles and miles away from being solved. Yeah, so in this list of problems, in general, I think they are hard problems. They turn out to be very hard problems. Okay. So let me talk about a couple of problems that maybe people have worked on, but they're fun to talk about. And they're still far from being solved, even in spite of a lot of work and some papers. One of them is this problem, which I like a lot, problem number 4. It's a tantalizingly simple problem to state. So I just take a polynomial, f, one variable. F is a polynomial, one variable, complex, one variable, t. So, we're just looking at f of t, integer coefficients. I'll write over z. So it's a very simple object, a polynomial with integer coefficients over z. And I asked something about how many zeros it has. Well, we have some estimate by the fundamental theorem of algebra and Bézout, generalized fundamental theorem of algebra. We have some estimate. And so here's the question. I write n again, I'm using z too much. I guess you should think of more letters. M of f equals the number of distinct integer zeros. Okay, so we want to estimate how many distinct integer zeros there are in a general polynomial of one variable. Okay, that's what I asked. You got an estimate on this. And so the question I asked more precisely, and this is very precise, m of f is bounded by, and now I can write it's just a constant to the m to the k. Polynomial bound like this is the number of zeros bounded by constant times what's m? I have to be more careful. Sorry. It's bounded by tau of f to a constant. Now I have to say what is tau of f. Okay, tau of f is going to be some quantity associated to f, which makes this the conjecture, some constant. Tau of F is as follows. So here's tau of F. So what I want to do is to write a description of F. A description of F starting just from scratch. So I want to write a sequence of things, like one. I take one, all right. I take the variable t, and then I do a sequence of things, A3, A4, and so on, where each of these A's in the sequence is defined by taking some arithmetic operation of the previous. So I take arithmetic operations of these to produce AK. Additions, subtractions, and multiplications. Only those. Okay, so that gives it a product. And finally, we get here a description of the coefficient. We get a description of tau of F. So we might start F of T is equal to T itself. And then we look at, you can take T squared, it's multiplication, T squared plus T, and so on. That's the kind of thing we could do. So we can produce any polynomial by such a sequence. Any polynomial over the integers can be built up through just starting with T, 1 and T, and using these arithmetic operations, multiplication, sum, and difference. Okay, so how many of these it takes, the number is tau. So eventually, if AK is equal to F of T, and K is minimal, the shortest program, you can say this is a program for computing polynomial F. It's a simple program. And K is minimal program, then that defines K is equal to tau of F. So every polynomial has a description like that. And we say tau of F is a minimal description. Any questions on that? And then this makes our question well posed. This is the number of zeros bounded by this polynomial invariant tau f to some fixed universal power, like 10.
Is tau bounded by the degree of f? Or
tau bounded by the degree of f.
Or like some polynomial.
So the degree of f can go up very quickly, right? So you know, if you take 2, or you take t squared, t to the fourth, then you have small tau, so it's bounded by the degree squared. Yeah, so you can double the degree at each stage in this sequence. In this sequence, you can double the degree each time, so the degree eventually becomes much, much bigger than tau. Okay? In that case, by the fundamental theorem of algebra, there are d zeros. And tau is exponentially smaller than the degree. But those are zeros scattered all over the complexes, not necessarily integer zeros. So you get close to that with a lot of guesses.
Can you get an example for a polynomial, how the sequence works?
How the sequence works? Here's an example. You take t squared plus t, and if you stop here, you get the polynomial t squared plus t. Okay, now we can take t cubed, because we can just take t squared times t. Now we can take t plus t, so you get 2t. Now we can add these two, so you get 2t plus t cubed. And so then you can stop at any point. But this is a program for doing 2t plus t cubed. Okay? So this, I think, in principle, should be fairly easy to understand this problem. Yes?
So I'm curious, so there are a lot of old-style number theory results that if you take an integer polynomial and then you look at solutions mod p, so it seems like you're asking some sort of universal, you know, version, yeah. Right? So you're looking at all solutions over z, so does this play nicely with those?
Well, I spent some, you know, back 15 years ago, I spent quite a bit of time thinking about all these things, and I didn't get that kind of answer. A number of other people have worked on it. Peter Bergesser is the person who worked on it more recently with some results. But what we did do, Mike Shub and I proved, if this is true, if yes, then P is not NP over the complex numbers. So we have a notion of NP completeness and all the complexity goes through for the complex numbers and for any field. And so we develop that. And those problems are still very, very hard. These complexity results for the these arithmetic operation versions, if you take Z2, then the arithmetic version is the same as the Turing version. But this is now over C. Still hard, but this tau conjecture, I call this the tau conjecture. Tau conjecture, it's not, I don't know if it's a conjecture because I didn't really conjecture it. I asked the question, let's call it a conjecture. If this is true, then P is not NP over C, which makes it unlikely to have a yes answer. So I guess our intuition would say this is unlikely to be true. But it's in that realm of some hard problems. Yes?
So is there any hardness result justifying keeping?
Is there what?
Is there any hardness result justifying keeping any polynomial and finding the tau, the red tau?
Hardness results, I'm not sure, probably not, I understand your question, not exactly, but Bergesser did prove some conditions for this in terms of a valence model of computation, so it's connected with some other things besides our own result. I mean, this is a see, is this a hardness result? If this is true, then P is not NP over C. That's kind of a hardness result.
I think the question is, how complicated is it to compute tau
for given F? For given F, probably finding a program for computing tau of F is not so bad. I don't think that's where the difficulties lie. Probably, although I'm not fresh on those things, but I think computing F, the problem of computing a given input F, find a program for that, I think that maybe that's not too bad. But I'm not sure. I think it's not so bad. Because you can write down some obvious programs that will do it. There are longer programs than one would like, and then one could start eliminating things in that chain of programs. Well, I'm not sure. Okay. Anyway, that's a problem I like a lot, even though I haven't thought about it myself too much for at least 15 years. Okay. Let's see. So let me talk about another problem. This is now a problem which is not on the original list. And it's also about a single polynomial, so it's tantalizing. And it's not a complexity theoretic question. It's problem 19, so it's a problem that appears in the second version. And it's received a lot of attention, called the mean value. problem. I found this problem back in the 70s, let's say, around 1980. Okay, so here's the mean value problem. Okay, so we're given any f. This is a complex polynomial. Okay, very simple, just arbitrary complex polynomial. And the question is, there exists theta, a critical point of f, so that just means f prime of theta equals zero, such that f, but say we're at, let me write this way, f of z minus f of theta divided by z minus theta, these are just complex numbers, is less than or equal I guess it's just a constant. In this form, is it just a constant? I think so. Let me just look at it again. You can tell by looking at the mean value theorem. So this should be f of z. Okay, so this looks like the mean value theorem. Okay, so this is a problem. And what I did back around 1980 or so, I said, yes, okay, if c equals 4, that'll be good. So I found an argument that used the mathematics of the Beamer-Bach conjecture. But that was, okay, so c equals 4 is okay. So we want to know if this is true for c equals 1. To make it look like a real mean value theorem. And as I say, I don't know if it's that important problem, but it's kind of a neat problem. It's so simple to state. It looks like a mean value type theorem. And it's received a lot of attention.
Sorry, shouldn't the derivative of that be a derivative?
What's that?
Shouldn't the f on the right-hand side be a derivative of that?
Yeah, for the mean value theorem, you're right.
Yes.
Yeah, right, good. Yeah, I call it mean value theorem to help me remember it. Then I forgot the derivative. Good. Yeah, so it looks like a mean value type theorem. But, and so people have, many mathematicians have worked on getting the C smaller and smaller. I think I noticed not only C equals 4, I can get a degree estimate. The degree of f is d, then I can get d minus 1 over d. So that was okay. And this number has gotten smaller and smaller. And so 1 is the problem. Okay now? So that makes, looks like it makes sense. Well, anyway, I wish you good luck, but a lot of people in kind of complex variable mathematics worked on this. See, when I found this for d minus 1 over d, not d minus 1 over d. What's that?
There.
Yeah, times 4, right? The conjecture is actually not 1, but d minus 1 over d. Yeah, the conjecture, the sharp conjecture is d minus 1 over d, but nobody's got 1 yet. So, best conjecture, d minus 1 over d. Then you can write down counterexamples pretty quickly. So it can't, this is the best you could possibly do, d minus 1 over d. And then you can just write something simple down like f of z equals z to the d or something like that. Very simple. And so you can do an experiment with this very, very easily. It's tantalizing. Just write down various polynomials and you just good feeling for this, but that's still open. Okay, well, that gives a little bit of a retrospective of what's happened to these palms and some of my early thoughts on it. But that was a long time ago, so forgive me for not being too handy with those things. In the articles I wrote at the time, there is somewhat more detail than I've expressed here. Thanks very much.
Have any questions?
Can you get a little bit of motivation for the centralizer problem?
Well, it's a little tricky. You know, even for the circle, if you take the manifold to be the circle, then if you work out a little while, you can probably do it. But see, given a diffeomorphism which commutes with something else instead of its powers, then you could probably perturb that diffeomorphism a little bit so it doesn't commute. But then you may introduce its commutation with other functions, other diffeomorphisms. So it's a subtle thing, even for the circle. I think a thesis student, I'm not sure if it's exactly right, but Nancy Capel, she was a student of mine at the time, way back at Berkeley, and she proved this kind of result, maybe even C infinity for the circle. So for the circle, I think it's okay. But as soon as you go anything higher, you run into this problem. As soon as you perturb it a little bit, you might introduce things. Introduce commutators.
All right. Thank you again, sir.
Sure.
It's a small token, but we got you something. It's a small brother.
Oh, okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Sure.